Good morning, viewers. Whenever we talk of festivals, what comes into our mind is we say, hey, happy festive times to you. Happy festive times with your loved ones. And what comes into our minds is joy, good food, togetherness, lovely times with our loved ones. And then what happens after the festival? So what we do at Banjara is we do celebrate festivals, but then we celebrate every day. We celebrate every moment. And hence we thought that in this festive times and upcoming, you know, so many different festivals through the year, it's only befitting that we bring to you a very appropriate topic, celebrating festivals of life, where you celebrate day in and day out. And how does one do that? Is it easy? Is it difficult? Can I really do it? Yes, you can do it. And how do you do it? That is what we all need to know. And bringing it live to you through StreamYard, through Facebook, is Dr. Ali Khwaja. A very warm and nice greetings from Team Banjara, and over to Dr. Ali.
Very, very good day to all of you. Happy day, I would say, because as Purni just now said, every day is a festival if you make your life that way. Why do you need a festival to be able to celebrate and wish everybody and get your friends and family members together and eat good food and all that? It can be done every day, isn't it? So how can it be done? What are the ways and means to make every day a nityotsava, a situation where everybody can celebrate at all times? To be able to do that, let us go in a little bit into the background or the history of what is this thing called festival. We cannot even visualize, you know, how harsh life was a few hundred years back. I'm talking primarily about India because that's my concern all the time, but it's more or less the same, I think, worldwide. So a few hundred years back, life was much, 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 much more difficult. Things were, even though we may say, oh, it was nice, it was laid back, and our ancestors and this and that, but let's face it, if any one of us is to be thrown by a time machine 500 or 1,000 years back, we would not survive 10 days at that time. That was how harsh life was in the good old days. People had to literally struggle on a day-to-day basis. People, for example, India, again, being an agricultural nation, 80-90% of our population survived on agriculture. And what was agriculture? You wait for the rains to come. You can't decide when to sow the crop, when to put in the seeds. You're all ready, but the rain has not come. The soil is not wet enough to take the seeds. So you wait and wait and wait. I think you must have seen the Amir Khan movie, Lagan, how they had to wait for sowing the seeds. Anyway, then what happens is, the rain gods favor you, the soil is okay, now you go and do the sowing. And then you wait. You can't say how many days it takes before the shoots start coming out. You can't convince the shoots to come out faster. You have to have patience. Finally, the shoots come out and you are happy. Then the crop starts growing. You have to protect it from all sorts of attacks. You have to protect it from drought. If there's no rain and if the sun is very harsh, the crop may die. If there are too many rains and the field gets flooded, the crop will die. There may be pesticides required. There may be pests, there may be insects coming. You have to protect them. When the crop is getting ready, you need to keep away the birds. You've seen those scarecrows put in the fields and all that. And then finally, you harvest the crop. Now that used to be such an occasion because nobody could predict where we are going to be when the harvesting time comes, how much of a harvest we'll get and things like that. And you're also aware that there used to be landlords, there used to be the British government or whoever it is who used to take away the lagan, you know, a huge chunk of your crop would also be given away to the authorities or the rajas or whoever, zamindars and things like that. So whatever was left when you have that, it was an occasion to celebrate. So that's how festivals came about. People started looking at change of climate people started connecting it to events like agriculture, harvesting, and those type of things. People started looking forward that when I have worked so hard for days and weeks and months, I need this little break. And if you go back into history, one thing you will see is all the festivals, almost all the festivals, were universal. Everybody celebrated them together. There was no differentiation between the communities and religions and all that. That came in much later, because originally festivals were community festivals. They were meant for everybody. The whole village used to celebrate. And when you do so much of hard work, those days there was no 5-day week and 6-day week, and there were no casual leave and earned leave or anything of that sort. If you are growing the crop, if you are doing whatever else you are doing, you had to work much more than 24/7, as we call it today. So when the day comes for us to celebrate, they used to really go out of the way to celebrate. The same thing used to happen, for example, in things like a daughter getting married and going away to another village or town. Now, in the normal course, it was not convenient, it was not affordable for the daughter to just, you know, catch a train or catch a flight and come back and be spend time with her parents. Days, weeks, months used to go past. And this girl would be absolutely pining for her home, her parents, her childhood friends. The festival was put as a means for her to claim her right to go back. And she would come back and she would be there for the festival. That sanctity was given. No, she has to be allowed to go to her parents. So many such things I can go on reeling. Anyway, just wanted to give you an idea of how this concept of the festivals developed over a period of time. Festivals were also ways and means to keep away the demons, to please the gods, and to ask for boons or blessings which were beyond our control. Most rural people in those good old areas were scared of floods, for example, if they were living near a river or near the sea. They were scared of drought, the rains may fail. They used to be scared of some, you know, neighboring people coming and attacking them and taking away their thing. They were scared of dacoits who used to raid the villages. So again, festivals and this and that became a means for people to get together, to pray, to ask for protection and all these type of things. And that is the reason why festivals acquired so much of significance over the years. But what happened now over a period of time is that the pandits and the mullahs and the priests and all these people took over control over the festivals. Every festival acquired a religious significance. So they started telling, on this festival, you have to get up at this time, you have to do this ritual, you have to clean yourself in this, you have to put that idol there, and you have to get flowers of this particular brand, and you have to put so much of coconut and agarbattis and things of that sort. And all these rituals and these and that started coming in. And sad to say that the general public started succumbing to it, not only at that time when people were very poor and helpless, but even today in 21st century, even in urban life where we are no longer dependent on the rains and the drought and the floods and all these type of things, we are still very scared. And a few of us who had thought that we have overcome the fear of nature's wrath and we can control over our lives, Madam Corona turned up. And she said, you think you can lead your life the way you want? You think just because you have money and power and everything, you can fly and jet across the whole world and you can build up your empires and you can have these billion-dollar companies and all that sort of thing? I'll teach you a lesson. And now people are again back to being scared the way we were in the good old days. And then the religious pundits started offering certain, you know, relief. If you do this puja, if you spend so much money, if you do this or that or whatever it is, then your problems will be over and you will lead a better life and those type of things. So slowly that, you know, carrot also started coming on the way. You perform all the rituals, you please the gods, you please your elders, you please your dead elders by paying homage to them. You make the sweet which your dead grandfather used to love to eat. He is dead and gone, he's not going to eat the sweet. But because he used to love the sweet, we make that sweet and we distribute it to everybody who may or may not want to eat that particular sweet. That's how it went on. When I look at the superstitions and the rituals and all that that have overtaken the true essence of what a festival is supposed to be, I feel sad. I feel, hey, this is not what a festival is supposed to be, you know, the way it is supposed to be. The essence of it, the spirit of the festival seemed to be being submerged into all these things like rituals and superstitions and all that. There's a wonderful story which I heard. I hope you people are not too old to listen to stories. If you say, hey, I used to love stories in my childhood, now I'm grown up and all that, I feel very sad for you. So those of you who say, yeah, story is always welcome, let me tell you a very nice, very touching story. In a particular village long ago, a drought happened. The crop failed. The monsoon failed. People did not have anything, no crop, no harvest, no food grains. What did they do? They survived on whatever food grain was left over. They pawned their jewelry, got some money and got some food grains from other villages or something of that sort. And they dragged on in misery, in poverty, but somehow keeping starvation away and moving on to the next year. The next year, they were all very keen that this year we must work very hard, have a good harvest, make up for whatever it is and again get some food grains to last us for some time. They got ready. And they started waiting for the rains to come. And the rains were due on a particular date. They did not come. People sitting forlorn, staring at the harsh sky, not a cloud on the horizon, waiting, waiting, waiting. Days went past. People started giving up hope. And they knew that if this year they don't have a proper harvest, they are literally going to starve to death. Things were so bad. So the village elders got together and they said, we have made all the preparations. We are all geared up. We have done everything possible that we could do. But the rains are eluding us. So what do we do? Now the only option left to us is to pray to God and to beseech God, beg God that please God save us. Nobody else can save us. Okay? So all the village elders got together, and since there were people of different communities, different faiths living in that village, they told the whole village, on day after tomorrow morning, everybody should come and assemble on the village square, all the villagers, men, women and children. And everyone should come with their own sign of their faith in God. Whatever you believe in, you bring that sign of God with you. And we will have an inter-religious, inter-community prayer. And we will all send our pleadings and prayers to Almighty and hope for the best. Good idea. So early morning, we see all the villagers trudging towards the village square. One was carrying a Bhagavad Gita. One was carrying a Bible. One was carrying a cross. Faith in God, no? You bring the symbol of your faith in God. So they were bringing that. One was carrying a statue of Ganesha. So like that, each one was coming, holding what they felt is their symbol of their faith in God. One little girl was happily walking towards the village square carrying an umbrella. The villagers looked at her and said, what's wrong with you? Elders told you to get something which indicates your faith in God. What are you carrying an umbrella and coming here? The little one gave a charming smile to all the wise old adults and said, "I have so much faith in God that I know that when I pray for rain, God will give rain. And I don't want to get wet going back home." That, dear viewers, is how festivals should be. That is how we should celebrate not just festivals, but literally life. Yes, the traditions should be upheld. There are a lot of very good traditions which we have acquired over the centuries. But let us not distort them into, as I said, silly rituals. Let us not make them into a parody where you do things only for the sake of fear, only for the sake of appeasing your elders or your ancestors who have gone away, or more than that, the Pandit, Pujari, Mullah, priest, whoever it is, because they have given the instructions and they have said this is the way it has to be done. We are all adults. We have had, most of us, all of us literally have had the privilege of a good education, a good upbringing, an exposure to what happens to the world, learning of life skills. Based on that, can we not make life much, much more pleasanter, happier? And can we not make these festivals as symbols of that? The same way, for example, as you have a family member whom you love very much. That family member has a date of birth, the date on which that person was born. So what do? Days ahead, you say, "Ha, birthday of my so-and-so beloved person. We are going to celebrate it." Why are you celebrating the birthday? There's no ritual to a birthday, right? You don't necessarily have to perform some rituals or some prayers or some agarbattis or these or that or something of that sort. You devise your own ways. You ask yourself what pleases the person, what will make the person happy. What should we do? How should we go about doing this celebration? And we do it to appease that loved one. And we get all the family members, maybe the extended family, everybody comes together. And they say, "Oh, a surprise party to you, and we've all come here to greet you." Each one thinks of a nice, very suitable, very touching gift or present to the birthday boy or birthday girl, even if it's the 90th birthday. And we come and give it. Can we not have that spirit to our festivals? Can we not look at that as an extension of what we are doing to one person, which we can do to the entire family and to the entire community and to the entire locality and to the entire city or state or country? We can start moving in that direction. Just to digress for a minute, let me tell you another very interesting, and this is a real life story, mind you, that it so happened that one of my students known to me, who was married, happily married, and did not have children. At one point of time, suddenly, without warning, her husband passed away. She was absolutely miserable. She was left alone in this world, no husband, no children. She was working, she had an income, she had a house, nice house, everything was there. But she became extremely lonely, depressed. She was going through a very bad patch. One of her friends, one fine day, decides to send her a message. "Hey, I wanted to tell you, one of my friends is visiting the city. He's a very handsome guy. And all women fall over themselves to win his approval. But I have asked him to come and stay with you in your house. And he can make you so happy. He can make you rich. He can do so many wonders for you. So get ready to welcome him." Can you imagine this poor lady who has recently lost her husband, who is still going through the grieving process? And this friend says, some handsome guy is going to come and live in your house with you. She was scandalized. And she wrote such a stinker to her friend and said, what do you think of yourself and this and that, whatever she could attack. And she cut her off completely. Tried a lot to get back to her and explain, but this lady just did not give her a chance. What is it that the other person wanted to convey? That the festival of Ganesha is coming. Lord Ganesha will come and stay with you in your house and bring you peace and love and prosperity. That is what she wanted to convey, but she didn't mention Ganesha. Now, this is just to show it's a real life incident. When you make only a ritual out of something, when you look beyond this, for example, take Ganesha as a festival. In my childhood, you know, very few people used to celebrate it. It was more of a Maharashtra-based and Mumbai-based festival. Other places where I stayed, we hardly knew that such a festival is there. Today, you see how it has spread all over the country. But what does it symbolize? Why do we celebrate? It's not just the religious aspect of a festival like Ganpati. There is so much more to it. There is a beginning of new things. There is a looking forward to prosperity. There are, I don't want to get into that because I am not a religious guru and I cannot give you details of that. But if you do take the trouble of finding out the essence behind any such festival, it's not just festivals of a particular religion or a particular community or something. Every festival of every community and every religion has got something which we can, you know, learn from. Take a simple example. In our great country, we have innumerable New Years. The Gregorian calendar, which we follow for the official purposes, starts on 1st January. So 1st January is supposed to be the calendar New Year. But primarily, New Year as a festival is a Christian festival. So on the midnight of 31st, Christians assemble in churches. They pray to God and they welcome the new year and things of that sort. But you see how people all over the country celebrate the new year, having no religious affiliation to that particular date of 1st of January. But you will find the whole country rises up in happiness and joy. In fact, I distinctly remember my childhood days in what was then known as Bombay. And that area called Gateway of India, on New Year's Eve, there used to be literally hundreds and thousands of people who would just walk in over there. No organized thing, no, you know, event managers, nothing of that sort. Somebody would scramble together a band and the band would be playing. And of course, the hawkers selling palli and this and that, they would be all over the place. And when the midnight bell used to strike, people used to raise up a huge cheer and they would congratulate each other and they would shake hands and they would hug each other. And the new year used to be welcomed by thousands of people, of which I don't think even 1% were Christians. That was the spirit and that is the spirit. We still have it in us. If we want to ensure that we want to bring in that type of, you know, harmony or whatever it is. Do we even take the trouble of finding out the festivals which are not ours? Every now and then I'm fascinated when I come across certain festivals. Never having lived in Kerala, for example, I didn't know about Onam and these type of festivals. But when I came to know, I started asking my Malayali friends. And I found out so much about Onam, which is so different from all the other festivals. It's celebrated only in Kerala or among Malayalis. But it is perhaps the most significant festival of Malayalis. Much more than Dasara, Diwali and all that put together. So what is it? Why does it celebrate? What does it happen? Do we take the trouble to find out? Or do we want to live only in our cocoons? No. We don't celebrate Onam. We are not Malayali. We will celebrate these and we are not these and something of that sort. The Koogs have their own festivals. So many communities that I know have their own festivals. Very few of us take interest to find out about I'm not saying that you also have to go to their places of worship or you have to celebrate or something. I'm not saying that. All I'm saying is that we should take interest. We should expand our horizons. You'll be amazed how people, you know, with all good intentions, tell their Christian friends, Happy Good Friday. Then there are those who tell their Muslim friends, Happy Muharram. Now, Good Friday and Muharram are both days of mourning. They symbolize the killing of Jesus Christ and of Prophet Muhammad's grandchildren. And here we are thinking very great about ourselves and saying, Happy Good Friday, Happy Muharram. I'm just giving one or two examples to show you how ignorant we are. And we don't even want to take the throne. Whereas, if it's my festival, I will move heaven and earth. I will apply for leave. I'll get very angry if my boss refuses leave on that particular day. I will travel. If there is no train booking, I will somehow go in an unreserved compartment or in a bus or something. I will reach my hometown and I will perform all the rituals and this and that without knowing head or tail of what it is all about. Without knowing why literally I'm doing it, without getting into what we call as the spirit of it. And when we talk about spirit of festivals, I see the great homemakers, those who refer to themselves as, I'm just a housewife. They bear the brunt of every festival, regardless of which caste, community or region you belong to. The homemaker has to slog. She is told by her mother-in-law and her mother-in-law's mother-in-law that she has to make a particular type of sweet which has to be done at this time, and this is the way the prayer has to be done, and this is the way this has to be done. It goes on and on and on. Nobody understands the reason, nobody understands the significance, but they do go ahead. Let us not look at things negatively. Let us not look at only the gloomy part of it. Let's look at the positive side of it. Let me share with you a few very interesting, very challenging things which festivals can give us. As they say in the TV serials, after the break.
Break time. Yes, back again with you all. Dr. Ali speaking to you on celebrating festival of life. And after the break, we are going to be ready to take your questions or for you to share some nice thoughts which you have about different festivals with us. And there's this nice song, the two songs which I just remembered. One is from the movie Roja. Dil ye chota sa, choti si aasha. So all that it takes is small things which will help you to make your festivals more enjoyable and more happy with all your people who will be visiting you, your family, your friends, your neighbors, the elders in the house, the kids in the house. And along with that, there is another very interesting song which says, Itti si hasi, itti si khushi, itta sa tukda chand ka khwabo ke tinko se chal banaye aashiya, which means that from small pieces and strands of hay, let's make a nice kazal, which is, you know, for us. So when we celebrate festivals, what we mean is that let's get into some nice things of having wonderful interpersonal relationships with people. Let us understand that what is it is a need of the other person. Can I help this person out in a much better way so that I can make my day, my festival, a more happier one? And Ali was just mentioning about the COVID time. I was just thinking that this year there has been a very strong news that most of the festivals have been a little lackluster. But then we can make it full of luster by you taking out on a totally different day, all your what do you say, your special best crockery, and surprise your family members with a nice set of crockery set on the table, and then they are wondering what's wrong, is there a festival today? You say, yes, I am celebrating a festival, and that's the festival of life, festival of today, festival of now. And on a very little funny note, there was this Iron Man who came around to give something, and he told, ma'am, yen business ne illa. So I told, why, what happened? I mean, it must, people are not going. He said, no, not only they are not going out anywhere, but then they are just moving around in their home clothes and things like that. So I have nothing to do, so and the shopping is not happening, ironing is not happening, so my dhanda is all gone. So celebrate festivals, wear your nice finery, and surprise people at home, because we are celebrating life. And in fact, for our children and many of us also, because of our children, the world is going to be a platform for us, and we are going to be in different cities, different cultures, celebrating different festivals. So let us get onto that same mode again, and give us your questions, your clarifications, your best thoughts, and over to Dr. Ali for his questions, for your questions and his answers.
Pune has already added luster to this particular festival of this program that we are doing, and we have Rashmi saying awesome song, Shweta saying nice voice, Purnima, and Navina saying very apt and beautiful songs, Purni. That's all that it takes, isn't it? We don't need to look at a great thing. Oh my God, so many more compliments are coming of your songs, Purni. I think next session of ours, we should keep aside at least 5-10 minutes to hear Purni singing. So many people are complimenting you on that. But if you take it in the proper spirit, that is exactly what we need to do in terms of celebrations, in terms of festivals. Vinita has rightly said, yes, Ali, no matter which festival, what religion, the spirit should be there to celebrate. And it's very interesting to understand various festivals which spread happiness. They also spread certain things to understand. A festival which went past the beginning of this month, what they wrongly referred to as Bakrid, it is actually Eid-ul-Zuha. It is a celebration, a festival of sacrifice. What are you willing to sacrifice from your life? The story behind it was of the great prophet Abraham. God said, what is it that you love most in this world? And Abraham said, my son. And God said, are you willing to sacrifice him? Chop off his neck to show that you love God and you're willing to follow God's instructions. Can you believe a more difficult sacrifice for a father, to chop off the neck of his most beloved son? And the story goes that he said, yes, if it is God's instructions, I will do it. But he said, when I see my son's face, I will not be able to, knock off his head. So he put a blindfold and he put his son there, and he got ready to chop off his head. Then it is said, by divine intercession, his son was removed and a goat was placed over there. So when Abraham chopped off the head, it was the goat that was sacrificed. And that's one of the reasons why they have given it this colloquial name called Bakrid, that sort of thing. But primarily, more than just celebrating and jumping up and down with joy or just singing songs, there are certain things that festivals help us to understand. Are you willing to make a sacrifice? The festivals in which people are asked to fast, every religion has got this fasting, remember that. Whenever I see a comparative study of religions, I am amazed at things that are common. Take a simple thing like Om, such a wonderful sound. It creates so much harmony if chanted in the correct way. You know what the Christians do when a prayer is finished? Amen. You know what the Muslims do in the mosque when the prayer gets over? Ameen. Slight variation, but they're doing all the same. So why do we need to argue? Why do we need to say I'm better than you, or you are wrong, I am right, or anything of that sort? Aha, Vidya says, the most important occasion in my year is my beloved dog's birthday. Even that can be a great festival, right? Ah, Varnika has brought out a very significant point. Festivals have become a costly affair. Yeah, yeah. Why? Who allowed them to become costly affairs? Ask yourself that. Who forces you to spend money? There's another new god that has come in of late. The god of consumerism. Days before a festival comes, you are bombarded by what you should buy. You should buy a house, you should buy a car, you should buy clothes, you should buy all your stuff for the house, you should buy a new fridge or microwave. Bombardment is endless, and people succumb to it. Once upon a time, people used to get a bonus once in a year, the major festival time, Diwali, Dussehra, or something of that sort. And yes, that was the occasion when children used to keep begging their lower middle class, labor class, those type of parents, I want a new dress, I want a new footwear or something. They used to say, wait till daddy gets bonus at the time of the festival, that time we'll buy you. And that bonus used to be over and above the regular salary, which was just enough to run the household. So it used to be a great occasion and we used to buy those things. Now we have gone far beyond that, isn't it? Today we don't need all these type of things. Like Navina says, I think and feel that when we get in touch with ourselves, be happy, get ready everywhere day to welcome every day with smile and full energy and living every moment to the fullest. That, according to me, is celebrating festival of life. I 100% agree with that. Sunita says, good morning. I absolutely agree that we need to celebrate festivals in the right spirit. I also feel that children should be aware of why festivals of other religions should be celebrated. We do this at home. Congratulations, Sunita. We celebrate all festivals here, be it Christmas, Eid, or Diwali. You know something? To be able to tell our children what is the significance of the festival celebrated by some other community or some other faith, we need to know ourselves, isn't it? Charity begins at home. If I have never taken interest, if I am a Hindu and I don't really understand or take any interest in, let's say, Muslim festivals, except, of course, if I have a Muslim neighbor who gives me biryani, and if I am not a vegetarian, then of course I really look forward to it because I know that my neighbor is going to send me a good helping of the biryani and I'm going to enjoy it because I can't make biryani the way my neighbor's wife makes and things of that sort. Those are minor things. But other than that, if I have not made that distinction, it becomes a little hypocritical to sit down as a lesson and to teach children. As it is, children have so many lessons to learn and so many things. Why add on something more theoretical to them? Why not get into the spirit of the whole thing? A simple thing I told you about Eid al-Zuha. Not just telling the story and this and that, but saying, come children, let's ask ourselves, what sacrifices do we make? You have a small child who comes from the neighborhood slum or maidservant's child or something. He doesn't have toys to play. Are you willing to sacrifice one of your good toys, toys which you like, not one which is, overused and broken and all that, but a good toy which you really love? You just bought it a few days back and you're playing with it every day. You're thrilled with it. Are you willing to make a sacrifice of that toy and give it to that poor child? Now we are teaching them something. So more than just the ritual of saying Hindus celebrate this, Muslims celebrate that, Christians celebrate that, can we get this essence? Every festival has some essence to it. And that is what we can sit down and talk it over with each other and find out more about it and things of that sort. Varnika says, nowadays festivals have been reduced to seeing movies in the TV and Swiggy food. Yes. Ask yourself, why are we doing this? Sadatul Islam says, all the festivals bring us joy. Instead of being sad, we must use the festivals to usher in happiness. And yes, we must teach children to celebrate the festivals of all religion. Not just celebrate, but to understand the essence of it. Why, when you are in the routine? As it is, you know that children get very upset about their routine. Earlier, it used to be going to school, coming back, doing homework. Now it is sitting in front of the laptop or the phone and doing the online classes and whatever they are being asked to do. So if we tell them this weekend, we will celebrate such and such festival. Let's say the coming Sunday is going to be Easter, whatever it is. Now, by faith, we are not Christians, so we have not been celebrating it. But why not? And what is the significance of Easter? What is the spirit behind this celebration called Easter? And do you know that Easter is preceded by the very touching and the very tragic event of what we refer to as Good Friday? And before that, there is a 40-day period called Lent, in which the devoted Christians fast. They sacrifice, give up a lot of things. They do penance, they do prayers. And then comes Easter, which they celebrate. So that is what I meant to say when we talk about the spirit of the whole thing. That you know that it's not just because it is Easter, so we will get a cake and we will, you know, start enjoying ourselves, or we'll go over to our Christian friend's house and celebrate with them or something of that sort. If we get into the essence of the thing, it makes a difference. Vidya says, festival is an event ordinarily celebrated by a community and centering on some characteristic aspect of the community and its religion or culture. It's often marked as a local or national holiday, Mela or Eid. That brings me perhaps to the most important point that I wanted to tell. We are this huge nation of 130 crore people. You will be amazed at the number of diversities, faiths, communities, festivals that take place. There are small communities tucked in here and there all over the country who have an identity of their own, who celebrate their own festivals, who have their own rituals, who have their own means of saying their prayers or whatever it may be. We'll never even come to know about them. But knowing that we are all part of this really amazing country, which is a melting pot of every possible, I don't think there's any community of the world which does not exist here. There is a very small but a significant community of Jews who live in Cochin and in Kolkata. Of course, all other faiths are represented over here. You name it, and we have people belonging to those particular communities. So why not start a little celebration, a little movement, I would like to call it, of celebrating national festivals? Can we not give significance to festivals which every Indian can proudly celebrate regardless of his religious inclination and things of that sort? We have the Independence Day, we have the Republic Day. These are the two major festivals of the country. We also have Gandhi Jayanti, which is considered to be the birthday of the father of the nation, and hence we treat it as a national holiday. We can add many more to that. Every state has a formation day. Karnataka has Rajyotsava day. Every state has its own day on which the state was created. So they celebrate the foundation of that particular state. Why can't we teach our children that regardless of which faith you belong to, regardless of which rituals, festivals, whatever else you do, you are an Indian first. And now let us celebrate in what way that we want to. So if there is a child who says that, you know, I love biryani, why is it that only on Eid the Muslim uncle sends us biryani? Why can't we do something of that sort? So why can't we get together on Independence Day, Republic Day, get a Muslim friend who cooks biryani very well and say, come on, let's all make this as our celebration, our food. You are a vegetarian, you have another 10 different options on the culinary side. Can you catch hold of some nice vegetarian family and find out what are the delicacies that they make? And on one particular day, this is what we are going to do. Now, this, why I'm telling you is, it is very, very sad to note, whether you agree or not, that people are totally ignorant of it. Rupa very correctly says that festival should be a joy of meeting other family members too, but losing the whole spirit of meeting them. Yes, that was how it was intended. I told you, when travel was difficult, when some daughter used to be living away into their, you know, in-laws place, or the bread earner used to go off somewhere far away serving in the army or serving somewhere else, and this and that, when things used to be difficult. Festivals were a means by which they were definitely given permission to go back and be with their family. It was supposed to be sacrosanct, and that's why nobody could, you know, deny that to them. Vidya says a festival is an event ordinarily celebrated by a community and centering on some characteristic aspect of that community and its religion or cultures. It is often marked as a local or national holiday. So yes, that's what I read earlier also. Now the point is, as I said, do have your festivals. Do respect your festivals. Do celebrate whatever your family, your elders, your community, your tradition tells you to do. I'm not saying we should belittle it. I'm not saying we should ignore it. But what I am saying is, can we in the same breath rise above that, you know, the level of our own community, our own caste, our own faith and this and that, to go to the highest level of celebration, and that is celebrating our country. Take a simple thing, Independence Day. Okay, even a small child knows, even an illiterate person knows, 15th of August 1947, we finally made the British leave and go away gracefully. We said bye-bye to them. We brought down the Union Jack of UK and raised our tricolor. And from that day onwards, we are an independent country. And therefore, we celebrate 15th of August as our Independence Day. Agreed. I do understand that. But the point is, how many of us and how many children know, on top of Independence Day, why do we celebrate Republic Day? Okay, we got independent, now we are independent. No, so now why another festival has to come in and say Independence Day and Republic Day? What's so great about this thing called Republic Day? Yes, Navina says, I think understanding another person, being empathetic and compassionate to that person, we can celebrate this festival of humanity. Irshad says we should try to think of our goodness, ungenerously diagnose and hold them. This is the true happiness and celebration, no doubt about that. But I come back to the point that I have been raising. Do you know that Republic Day, 26th of January 1950, is celebrated because we got independence? 1947, August 15th, we got independence. The British said, okay, now you take care of yourself, you're gone. Do you know what they left behind? They left behind 300 semi-independent kingdoms. They left behind so many different communities. They left behind so many fragments of our country, which didn't seem to connect to the rest of the country. And they said that we are different from all of you and we don't want to have anything to do with you, whether the British are here or not, we don't connect, we don't belong to you. We were left behind with miserable things like untouchability and those type of things which were a part of our lifestyle. We had these jagir systems and all that, where the peasants were treated very badly. They did not have any basic rights. That is what the British left. So many countries got independence around the time that India got independence. At least half of them crumbled and finally were taken over by dictators. And the citizens today say that our colonial masters, be it the Dutch or the French or the British, they were far better than these dictators who are so cruel and callous against their own people. India, a gigantic country, so diverse, so difficult to even govern, because at that time, for an official to reach from, let's say, Delhi to one extreme part of the country where they had to enforce certain laws would take not hours, it would take days. Sometimes you wouldn't be sure how long it will take, because there would be rains or landslides, or the roads would be blocked, or trains would not be functioning and things like that. That's what we inherited. But what did we do? We got down to the job of consolidating. And from that time till 26th of January 1950, we evolved a constitution, one of the best constitutions in the whole world. Whenever we see something, regardless of which right wing, left wing, center wing, whatever line of thought you belong to, whenever you feel that there is some threat, something is not going okay with the country, somebody is trying to sabotage, somebody is trying to bring in something which should not be coming into our country, it is the constitution that holds us together. Every public representative, be it a panchayat member, MLA, MP, minister, anybody, before he is handed over the reins of his office, has to take an oath to the constitution, not to his party, not to his leader, not to his God or something. He has to take an oath that he will support, sustain, and strengthen the constitution. That constitution was made within 2.5 years, which was a record, covering every aspect. If you go through the constitution, how many diverse things have been included in that. Not only from the administrative point of view, every religion, every community had their own rules and regulations with regard to, let's say, marriage and divorce, with regard to inheritances, with regard to so many things. All that was incorporated into the constitution in 26 January 1950, our constitution came in. It has been 70 years. We have already celebrated the 70th Republic Day. Now, isn't that something worth celebration for every Indian? Shouldn't we tell our children that along with whatever we are celebrating as part of our community and our faith, one of the strongest festivals to celebrate all of us together is the Republic Day, the Independence Day? And can we fulfill that in us? If you allow me to be critical, as one of you said about festivals, Republic Day, Independence Day becomes even more a day of Netflix and Swiggy and malls and whatever you want to call it. Those who have an obligation like schools or government offices, they go and do their flag hoisting in the morning, and that's the end of the celebration. After that, we spend the whole day with our family saying, yay, we have a day off. And it's not our festival, so no rituals. Even the housewife is free. She doesn't have to slog away in the kitchen or in the puja room. So wonderful. Come on, let's celebrate. Let's go for a picnic. And even if it's lockdown days, then we will have our own picnic at home. Swiggy Zindabad and Netflix Zindabad. And that's enough for us. That's not how life should be. No? So I definitely wanted to get this point across. Varnika says, this Independence Day, I noticed that our children thought It's a flag day. Just salute and have chocolates. We have to sensitize our children about the freedom struggle. Absolutely right. These are the type of things that I really want us. It will take time. It will take effort. Let's make a beginning. Let's inculcate that spirit of togetherness, oneness. One of the largest 130 crores, barring China, we are the most populous country in the whole world. And unlike China, we have got literally hundreds of languages, hundreds of religions and communities, hundreds of different rituals and festivals, and you name it, whatever it is. We have all that, and yet we stand as one country. Be it an external threat of aggression by another country, be it a natural calamity like a tsunami or an earthquake, be it a pandemic like coronavirus, we all stand as one country. Now, if we can strengthen that, starting with ourselves, unless I believe in it, I can't teach it to my children or anybody else. Let's be very clear about that. We are not going to do it as a ritual just to tell children, hey, you know, Independence Day is coming and what is the importance of that? And you know, what was Gandhiji and freedom fighters and these and that? As I said, it becomes another lesson added to the children who are learning so many different subjects. We have to get into that spirit. And that spirit will radiate to the younger people. And we talk to them, to our children, to anybody. You know, the new generation. If we can sow that seed, like I was telling you about harvest festivals, if we can sow that seed, the seed will germinate on its own, the rains will come, the crop will come. We may or may not be there, but the next generation will take over. This is what I'm looking forward to. I'm a very optimistic person. Even if 10 of you out of the hundreds who are watching this program decide to take it up, I am going to be very happy, because the ripple effect from those 10 will go to 100, to 1,000, to 10,000, and the message will carry through. So let us celebrate the greatest festivals of our country, that is our national holidays and things that we all need to be proud of. Jai Hind. Thank you. And over to Seema.
Celebrations called life, celebrations, and a beautiful, refreshing, you know, way of looking at celebrating our festivals. So I've come here to tell you all that here in Banjara, I think every minute, you know, every day, every minute, we really enjoy ourselves. We have, you know, because it's all ultimately talks about the human connection, the you know, the personal relationships and so on and so forth. I would also like to tell you that we have recently started our DCS 21. This is the 22nd batch of our diploma in counseling skills, and it is so nice to see a class full of bustling students in Banjara again. And also, these were the two batches which started recently, and we are starting with another two batches of our Diploma in Counseling Skills course, another two teams, starting 15th and 16th of September. So if you are interested in pausing for a minute, thinking about life, thinking about where you are, and wanting to you know, relook at the way things are moving, things are, you know, the future and all that, I think this is a wonderful course, which is like a, you know, like a checkpoint in your life. And I know many of you are DCS students who participate and who come every Saturday to watch this show. And many, you know, students from this batch itself as well. So I would like to say that if you are interested in stopping and re-looking at things, you are most welcome to get in touch with us. We can give you more information about this course, which is called our Diploma in Counseling Skills. Already 4,500 counselors have done the training and course from here, and the feedback and what they have to say about the course and how they have started looking at life and celebrating every moment is very heartwarming. So welcome you all to come reach us and call us up if you want any more details about this course. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful day. We meet you again next Saturday.